detecting DeFi bugs and arbitrage opportunities using symbolic execution. Bernhard, take it away.
All right, yeah. So like you already said, this talk is about detecting profit opportunities on the Ethereum blockchain using program analysis techniques. I've been working on this research since a couple of months because we had some large-scale hacks of within the DeFi ecosystem, including BZX, for instance. We had the breakdown of Maker because of the big Ether price dump that happened and so on. So this kind of systemic composability vulnerabilities that result from the interaction of different DeFi components are becoming more important. And we're now trying to adapt our toolset that we already have for detecting common vulnerabilities to also detect these kinds of systemic flaws. So I'm gonna try to structure this talk in a way to go from very easy to very complicated. And I'm gonna start with explaining how symbolic execution works in principle and how it's applied in bug detection and in simple scenarios where you have just one smart contract that has some kind of Ether extraction, or maybe you can kill the contract and withdraw the Ether. And then we'll move on to DeFi Lego castles that consists of different smart contracts and contract accounts that interact with each other. And we're going to look at tools that can also deal with this kind of setup and the challenges that we have in developing these tools. So the tools we'll be using in this talk, the first one is Mithril, which is an open source symbolic analyzer that was created by me like a few years ago. It's been around for a while. It's more suited for advanced users. So it's like a command line tool that has a lot of options and arguments. And if you want to use it correctly, you need to know what you are doing. So it's more suited for Solidity or smart contract auditors. And we also have an API that's more suited for developers and make things a bit easier because it integrates with typical IDEs like Remix and Truffle and code editors and CI pipelines and so on. But both use the same basic principles. So symbolic execution, MythX also adds bytecode fuzzing and static checks on the Solidity code to give you a bit more comprehensive results. So MythX has a commercial version as well, but for any examples that I'm going to show in this talk, you can do everything for completely free. So you can either use Mithril or MythX in the free plan, and you should be able to reproduce everything. All right, so the quick explanation on symbolic execution and how it works and why it is useful in this context. So let's imagine you have a piece of smart contract source code that you have a class that represents a cat. And depending on how you call this function, the cat can either die or not die, right? So there's a Boolean variable that determines whether you grant the cat to survive. And if you set this to false, then obviously the cat will die, right? Now, if you execute this code, there are two possible paths that the execution can take. Either this variable is true, so the cat will survive, or not, and then the cat will self-destruct. So what we do now with symbolic execution is that we explore all possible paths through the contract, and we take note of the constraints that are put on certain states, right? So if I go here and I have a conditional jump, then I know that when a certain variable is set to true or one, then I will get, I will follow this path, and otherwise I will follow the other path. And I can represent all these states as propositional formulas. And the cool thing is about this that I can then solve those formulas and I can try to determine the call data values that result in a certain thing that I want. So if I wanted to kill the cat for some reason, I would feed this formula into the SMT solver and it would calculate the values that I need to input to do that. So that's the expression and it's just a simple Boolean logical expression that can be simplified and solved. And this is the output, right? So how does that look in a real world scenario? Start with something very simple that you have probably heard about. So in 2017, we had a very well-known hack of the Parity Wallet library, where a library contract was killed by an anonymous guy and a lot of funds got lost. I think it was like $300 million because the code was frozen and became unusable. And the problem here was that there was a kill function and the kill function was restricted to be only called by the owner. But there was also an initialization function that allowed anybody to set the owner as long as the contract had not yet been initialized. And due to the circumstances of how this contract was deployed, this function had never been called. So it was possible to kill not only the contract, but also withdraw all the ether on the contract to anybody. Right. And symbolic execution is very suited to detect this. For the MythX version, which is the API I mentioned before, we have Remix integration. So if you have some source code that you want to check, you can load it in Remix and compile it, and then you run it through MythX. Just hit the Analyze button, and it will point out things that it thinks are wrong with the contract. Like this, for example, so you shouldn't have loops over unbounded data structures. And yeah, most importantly, the contract can be killed by anyone. And yeah, in this context, it's important to know how this can happen. So you also get a call data trace of what exactly was executed to achieve this, which is initializing the wallet with the init wallet function and then killing the wallet. And also MythX is smart enough to also realize that you can steal the ether on the contract and send it to yourself by entering your address here. Yeah, so that's a very basic demo of determining ways of how you can increase your own ether balance by running a certain sequence of transactions. But if you think about it, this is what we always want, right? So we want to have some kind of state transition that increases our own balance of ether in the end, no matter how, right? So another example for this. So imagine you have a liquidity pool or a like trader token that can buy and sell tokens, and it looks like this. You have a swap function that changes tokens for ETH and a swap function that changes ETH for tokens. And there's some kind of price calculation that determines the price. And spoiler, something can go wrong in this contract. So maybe anybody wants to guess what it is. Hands up. Nobody? Okay, yeah. So the way we determine this in this case is by creating so-called invariants, which are checks that we think that should hold for this contract. Sorry. So this type of checks are called invariants, and invariants tell you things that you would expect to hold for this contract at all cases. And one of these is that anytime if somebody buys tokens or gets an increased amount of tokens, then they should also pay Ether for the token, which means that the contract account balance should have increased at the same time. There can be no case where somebody mints tokens for free, right? And the other way around, and you can boil this down to four invariants. Now, if we check this, we are going to use this verifier contract. And we are looking for failed assertions. So we are looking for counter examples to these rules that we have defined here. And it's going to take a couple of minutes, probably. So in the meantime, let's look at the structure of this contract. So what happens here is we solve the old balance of the contract that the contract has initially, and then we compare the balance after the transaction with the balance that we saved before, right? And the same for the token balances. Let's give this a few more seconds.
Can you show the source code again of the contract?
Yep. Still taking guesses. You have a few more seconds. So let's see, if you transfer tokens for ETH, then it will calculate the price, and the price is, of course, the number of tokens divided by the tokens that you want to buy. The tokens that you get for each ETH, right? And the other way around. Okay, so this is taking pretty long. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at the result of running this like just an hour ago. If I can find it. Yeah, okay, this is now done. So let's look at the two things it has detected. The first invariant that was violated is that there is a case where the contract account balance doesn't increase even though the sender gets tokens. And if you look now at the generated trace, you can see that this happens if the user calls tokens for ETH with an input of 8 way. And now if you look at this price formula, you can see that the first thing that happens here is a division, right? So if the number of tokens is very low, and this will be divided by 10, and you have to consider that Solidity doesn't have any floating point numbers. So what it will do is, if there's a division of 8 by 10, it will just round it down to 0, right? So you essentially, you will get 0 multiplied by 0, and it will return a 0 price, which means that you can get those 8 tokens for a 0 price. So if you're now an attacker, you can just repeat this over and over again, and you can withdraw all the tokens from the contract from for zero ether. And that's an edge case basically before, because it's not very intuitive, a very intuitive feature of Solidity that it happens that way, like the order of operations and the lack of a floating point and the way that rounding works. So that's a mistake that's easy to make, right? And you can catch it with this kind of invariance. And that's also important in the context of composability bugs, because the bugs often result from this kind of little mistakes in one of the Lego components that then accumulate to something bigger and cause a big problem. So any questions on that so far?
No questions in the chat so far.
Right, so I mentioned before that if you use a tool like Mithril, then all this tool will do is look for the thing you tell it to look for. And in most cases, you want it to look for ways to increase your balance of ether or your balance of some token. And for the tool, there is no difference whether you are exploiting a bug or you're doing a legit trade. So let's assume you have two exchanges and there's a price imbalance between the exchanges. The tool will detect this, and that's usually a legit arbitrage opportunity, right? There's nothing wrong about doing that. But on the other hand, like we saw in the BZX hack, there are also instances where you could call what's going on manipulation or even exploitation of a bug. I'm going to go through this attack in a moment. Just one more thing that's important that changes the game a bit is flash loans. So flash loans provide a shitload of liquidity to anybody who wants it. You can just borrow, I don't know, 10,000 plus ether and use them to do anything you want atomically within a transaction, as long as you pay it back in the same transaction. And this allows you to do pump and dumps and things that usually only whales can do because they have the liquidity to do it. Because those funds are available. And this makes the whole attack surface or the potential group of attackers simply much bigger. So how did the BZX exploit work? BZX is, I don't know if it's still around, a platform for that offered loans and also leveraged short and long positions on assets. And so what happened in this case was that an attacker borrowed 10,000 ETH with a flash loan and used then half of that ETH to borrow 112 WBTC or Wrapped Bitcoin on Compound. And they then did a margin trade on BZX. So a margin short, to be specific. So they deposited 1,300 ETH and BZX. And the margin short gives you the possibility to trade with more ETH than you deposited. In this type, it's a five times margin, so a multiplier of five. So you can cause BZX to trade with you with over 5,000 Ether. And so that what the attacker did was to do a margin short on ETH in favor of Wrapped Bitcoin. And when you do a short, what will happen is that you borrow the ETH, and the borrowed ETH will be used to borrow Bitcoin on some exchange. And BZX will use Kyber for the price feed. And Kyber detected that the best price is on Uniswap. And so the whole trade happened on Uniswap. But the problem here is that liquidity of Wrapped Bitcoin is very, very low. So if you buy a high amount of that, the price on Uniswap will just shoot up and will be much higher than anywhere else on the market, right? So what was missing on BZX was a sanity check that once this collateralized, once this leveraged short was opened, that the WBTC it got actually was enough to collateralize or to collateralize this loan, right? And because BZX only saw the price on Uniswap, it thought that the red Bitcoin was worth much more than it actually was, right? So what the attacker could do now was to sell the Bitcoin borrowed on Compound back for Ether and settle the flash loan and walk away with a profit of $355,000. And yeah, BZX was left holding the bag because they had the WBTC, which were by far not enough to cover the loan, the margin trade, and would have to accept that this margin trade is defaulted, right? There's a very nice analysis from PackShield on Medium if you want to see all the transactions in detail. So this attack was quite complicated. So I will give a few simpler examples to illustrate how we can detect the same kind of thing with tools. So the basic approach is that we use the same symbolic execution techniques and we explore the possible path, but this time over multiple contracts and standard components like Uniswap or whatever at the current state of the blockchain, and we search for any opportunities that increase our balance, right? And we combined it this with data from the actual Ethereum mainnet because we want to know if at that instant in time there's an opportunity to exploit this or not, right? So we have to adapt our tools a bit. First of all, we have to support interactions over multiple contracts, and we also need to have a way to access the state of the blockchain during the analysis or somehow seed our analysis with the current state, including account balances, who has how many tokens, what do price oracles say, and so on. And so basically, this can be the foundation of a security tool to detect BZX-like bugs, but also for a regular trading bot, because like I said, it can also detect arbitrage opportunities. But in a trading bot case, it has to be much faster because you need to detect those opportunities before everybody else, and ideally within the block time. So like a maximum of 10 to 20 seconds, you need to have a usable result. And that's not so easy. So I would like first to show in principle how symbolic execution can be applied here. And as you see, I use Remix a lot and have no idea where anything is. Tips. Give me a second to find the right contract. All right. So this is a simplified simulation of a DeFi environment that basically simulates Ether balances and token balances and some of the standard components that are available in the DeFi ecosystem. So if you're familiar with Uniswap, you know that Uniswap is actually a pretty simple system. What to do is using a constant product pool, a constant product price formula. So all it does is you have two reserves. One is an ETH reserve and one is a token reserve. And the price determination makes sure that the product of both prices is always consistent. And so that means that the market determines the price, right? If you buy one token, then the price of the token goes up and the price of the other token goes down, and it should balance itself out with the rest of the market. And yeah, I ported some of these functions from Uniswap here. And I also added a collateralized loan function. And in this case, we say, okay, you can take a loan if your collateral, if your token collateral is worth more than twice the ether you want to borrow. So a 200% collateralization ratio. And if you look at this contract, now there's actually a similar bug to what we saw in BZX, or yeah, we call it a pump and dump or Oracle bug, because this price formula, it solely relies on what the price in the constant product price pool is, right? So if you were to pump that price to a very high value, it would overvalue the collateral and you could trick it into borrowing more ether than you actually should be able to borrow, because the price of the token in comparison to the rest of the market is so high, right? And yeah, it's surprisingly simple to check for this kind of bug, because all we need to do is to create an assertion and check whether there's any way to increase our ether balance, right? And we link it to this contract. And what our tool does is to execute all those functions in all combinations and solve for all possible inputs to find any way of increasing the balance. But in this case, it's a little bit more complex. So I would have to run the standard analysis, which takes about 15 minutes. So I'm not going to do that now. And I'm going to just show you a result that I've already prepared. This is an analysis of that contract. And if you look here, you see we have detected an arbitrage opportunity that increases the balance. And to check out the test cases, you see the transaction sequence that that the symbolic analyzer found. So it will first trade ETH to tokens, and this now pumps the price in the liquidity pool, and it will then take out a loan collateralized by the tokens of 1,537 Ether, and it can now pay back the flash loan of 1,000 Ether that it has, and will have 537 Ether left, right? And then it will just quit and be finished. And again, the exchange will be holding the bag, because the wrapped Bitcoin or whatever the collateral is, it will actually not be worth enough to justify taking this loan, right? So yeah, that's how this works in principle. But now the problem is that in the real world, we don't just work with one contract. We have multiple contracts. And so for this kind of task at the moment, you cannot use MythX, and you cannot do this from Remix or the IDE, because it cannot do multi-contract setups yet. So you have to use our open source tools, which is a bit more elaborate to use. I've prepared a couple of examples here on Ganache. They're already deployed, I hope. Yeah. Okay, so let's look at interacting with the blockchain first. Token sale. It's pretty hard to find anything here because there's no search function. Oh, yeah. Right, so another vulnerability. Anybody want to take a guess And in the meantime, I'm just going to run Mithril on this. And I will show you the output later. But this actually will run for a couple of minutes, I think.
And if you guys want to take a guess, just drop it in the channel.
Right. Okay. What's the vulnerability? So the contract buys and sells tokens, right? And it's pretty simple. If you buy tokens, the value of Ether you send must equal the product of the number of tokens you want to buy at the price. And if this is true, then you get more tokens. If you sell tokens, then your balance must be higher than the number of tokens, and then the tokens you sell will be deducted, and you will get the Ether, value of number tokens times price per token. Pretty straightforward. Don't be shy. You can take guesses and you can be wrong. It's completely okay.
I think you might have stumped him.
And Mithril is still running. Okay, so I'm going to give you a little spoiler. There is an integer overflow here. So in Solidity or the EVM, integers are represented by 256-bit values, right? So there is a maximum integer value that this type of variable can hold. And if num tokens becomes too high and you multiply the price per token, this can overflow and become a very low value or even zero, right? And that means you would be able to buy a lot of tokens for zero Ether, right? And then after this, you can sell those tokens for like any regular price. And if that contract has Ether, you will get that Ether from the contract. And this is also something that Mithril can detect. So, yeah, it's not that nicely decoded here, but what it tells you is buying tokens. And this value here is a very, very large integer. And if you enter this, you will realize that multiplying this integer with the price will exactly overflow to zero. So you will get a super huge amount of billions of tokens. And then in the next transaction, you sell them. So these first four bytes are actually function signature of selling, and then Mithril just generates a random super high number that makes you very rich. So let's go through the debugging output, how this actually works from the Mithril side. So what Mithril does is you give it an Ethereum address. And in this case, this points to Ganache, but you can also do this with mainnet contracts. And you give it a model name that's optional, but in this case, we only want to know if there's a way to get Ether out of the contract. And what Mithril does is it loads the data it needs from the blockchain dynamically. So it will first get the code from that contract, it will run the code, and then every time there's access to a state variable, it will do an RPC call to get the actual value on the blockchain to check balances and so on, and storage variables. So you always have a live view basically of what's going on currently in the state. I have a better example for this a bit later. OK, Okay, multi-contract arbitrage. So that's the most complicated one. And I have another setup here. So the idea is that now we want to have a real environment that involves an ERC20 token and several traders with several balances that are willing to sell and buy the token at different prices. So yeah, at this point, I would like to show something that I'm building currently. Which is called the DeFi Hacking Playground. And I'm building a collection of basic DeFi Legos and scenario scripts. So this is very useful for researching this kind of tools and testing them, because you can start from very simple setups and make things more complex over time, right? So you might want to have an ERC20 or an exchange that's modeled after Uniswap and a loans contract, and then you can set up different scenarios where these contracts have different balances, and then you can run your tools against those contracts and make sure they work. So yeah, any pull requests or any help on this, of course, appreciated. So what I set up here is a token, an ERC20 token, and two traders. And one trader trades the token for a price of 200 Wei, and the other trader has a price of, where is it? 100 Wei. So basically, if I would buy tokens for 100 Wei and sell them for 200 Wei, I would make a profit, right? So now we would expect a tool to detect this profit opportunity. So what we do here is we set up another contract and we tell it about the interfaces to all those traders, right? We tell it it can buy tokens here and sell tokens and buy tokens at B and sell tokens at B. And this will cause Mithril to check all the possibilities and construct symbolic representations of all the final states. And then it will be able to check with the SMT solver if there's any profit opportunity or not. And yeah, so at this stage, this is a very early demo that also takes long to execute. We'll just run this in the background for now and show you the result when it's done. And here you can see there's a lot more RPC requests, because now we need to know about the exact balances of everybody, and we need to have the code of the token, we need to have the code of the traders, we need to know exactly how each of these entities behaves and what their state is and what their balances are to find out whether we can make a profit or not, right? So I let this run for now. And yeah, like you saw, this kind of analysis is still very slow. So the problem is that we have a lot of redundant symbolic execution, because if you think about it, the code of smart contracts doesn't change, right? So basically all you would have to do to symbolically execute it once and then remember the constraint sets that you have and just insert with every block the new values on the blockchain, the new balances or everything you need. And then you pass all of this to the solver. So what you essentially do is auto-creating mathematical formulas that you can have a hopefully very strong machine solve, and that output profit opportunities, right? Yeah, DeFi Hacking Playground. So the goal here really is to create a tool that is very efficient at this kind of thing, which can either be a fork of Mithril and something new, or just like a plugin. And to improve the performance in a way that it's definitely useful for detecting systematic composability bugs like we had over the past few months, but also potentially for arbitrage trading. So that could be something that miners use, for instance, to extract MEV or make additional profits from legitimate arbitrage opportunities and making the market more efficient, which is a good thing. Let's see if we saw it yet. So I think we're already running out of time. Just show you one more tool. This is something we made for DEFCON, not the Ethereum DEFCON, the hacker conference, which demonstrate how you can use the output from Mithril to auto-create the transactions that, in this case, steal Ether or self-destruct the contract. But you can use the same thing, of course, to extend the functionality of the analyzer with automated trading functionality. So what it does is it takes the concrete outputs that Mithril has created, and it sends the actual transactions to the blockchain, and then also checks whether your balance has increased or not. And I actually broke this tool recently because it's not compatible with the latest version of Mithril anymore. But I can show you a video of that. Hope you can see that. So again, that's the vulnerable parity wallet library. So I'm deploying this to Ganache, giving it some ether. So there's some ether to withdraw from it. And you can see on Ganache now that the balance of the creator is reduced by the 5 ether. And yeah, so Scrooge McEtherfees has a simple config where you tell it what blockchain to connect to. And all you need to do is to run it and give it the target address. It will then run Mithril and symbolic analysis and will tell you about any possibilities of extracting Ether from the contract. In this case, it has found 1. And it will also tell you the transactions you have to send and give you an interactive interface to execute those transactions. So you see rates, bot 0, and it has a couple of steps that it needs to execute. It's 2 transactions in total. And then you run execute. And this will now send the transactions to the blockchain and tell you whether you have actually increased your balance or not. And you see here that the attacker, which is the second address, has gained 5 ether in the process. So that's automation. And yeah, like if you use this on the actual blockchain, and to be honest, a lot of people are doing this and are fighting for these profit opportunities already, then it's, if you are new in this field, then it's very, very dangerous, because not only are people putting up honeypots that look like they would be a profit opportunity, but actually take your ether, they're also front-running bots. So if you send any transactions that could generate a profit for you, there will be people monitoring the blockchain and see your transactions and quickly send another transaction with a higher gas price to be faster than you and to get the money. So you are doing all the work and they basically just stealing your idea and front running you. And in the end, you almost always lose. So it's very, very difficult unless you know what you're really doing. So in the meantime, this should be finished, right? So yeah, the result is we have to buy tokens and we have to sell tokens. I'm not sure if the resolving of function names here is correct. I have some other bug, but I think the general idea is okay. Still some bugs to fix there. So that's the demo of having an environment or a property check that spans multiple contracts, including an ERC-20 with all the approve and all the ERC-20 logic. All right. So for the last couple of slides, this is a honeypot that we ran last year at DEF CON. Just to try out if anybody, any people would go into the trap, and we obviously sent any of the ether back we got from this. Can anybody guess what happens here? So we deployed this contract and we made it look like it was possible that you can become the owner of this contract and withdraw all the balance. And we put like, I don't know, 5 Ether on that. But to become the owner, you have to send 1 Ether yourself, right? But other than that, it looks legit. Okay, if nobody wants to guess, so the trick here is actually that we monitor the mempool, and if we see anybody trying to do this, we front run them with their own transaction and quickly become the owner before that person becomes the owner. So once the transaction of the attacker runs, we will still accept the 1 Ether of the attacker, but the attack will not work. So they will just lose the 1 Ether and then we can withdraw it. And yeah, there's a lot of those. A lot of them are really funny. Let me show one more. Another honeypot, that's an older one. It's a contract where you can multiplicate your ether. So you send some ether and you get 3 times data back, which is awesome. And that's the function that does this. Does anybody see a problem with that? Okay, so it seems to be the case that if you send more than the contract's balance, then you will get all the contract's ether plus what you sent yourself. But the problem is that the moment you call these functions, your own message value is already added to the balance. So this can never be true, right? So everything that will happen is that you send ether and the contract will keep it. And at some later point, the owner will come and withdraw everything that's on the contract. So very cool stuff. If you're interested in that, just Google for honeypots. There are lots of articles and write-ups. So that's it for the presentation. We would also like to offer everybody a super secret promo code where you can get a free MythX dev plan. So we do have a free version as well, but the dev plan is more awesome. And with this code, you can try it out for free. And I'm happy to share that later on the Discord chat if that's okay. Or you can also PM me and I'll send you the code. This is our website. Couple of other announcements. There is a raffle going on where you can win an awesome crypto wallet and some other prizes. So go to raffle and noncon.org to sign up. And of course, most importantly, the CryptoVena after party that's happening on CryptoVoxels this evening. This will be the best after party yet because it's the final party and everybody will be there. And there will be free beers, of different kinds and all kinds of live music and other stuff. So definitely don't miss this. And yeah, that's it.